first festival was held in the Savoy in Cork and was the brainchild of Corkman Dermot Breen.
Imagine Ireland in the 1950s, a man, an entrepreneurial man like Dermot Breen, going to Rome to seek the approval for the status of the International Film Festival. In 1950s Ireland, remember, there was no indigenous film industry to talk of. It was a country that was possibly very much dictated to and dominated by state censorship. So this was a huge boost for the city to have an International Cork Film Festival in 1956.
Despite Cork not even having an airport till 1961, the festival built up a strong international reputation and attracted many stars of the silver screen, including Trevor Howard. With stars, of course, came star behaviour.
Well, actually, there was a British starlet, Dawn Adams, who stayed in the Metropole Hotel and demanded a milk bath a la Cleopatra style. People thought that it was a farcical request, though she was ignored. And that would have been more of the no-nonsense style that Dermot Breen brought to the festival.
It didn't stop at big film names, though. The festival even attracted celebrity volunteers.
At one stage, Tony O'Reilly, the entrepreneur, was one of the people who helped out and volunteered at the festival. And he opined that it was his only way of getting near Hollywood actors that he'd always revered. So the idea of the women in their finery and the men in their black tie was something that was part of the whole atmosphere of the festival.
The black tie code ended in 1983, and for a while the social scene and the festival club seemed almost to take precedence over the films.
I go over to the club every night without fail. All the lads are there, the entire gang, plenty of booze and good gas, you know what I mean? And then, of course, we go out to Blarney with the stars, and there's more booze out there. That's good fun, the whole thing. Of course, the firm gives me the week off, you know, to attend the festival because it is good publicity, you know
what I mean? Oh, yes. Well, it's only 11:30 a.m. now. Are you not going to the club very early?
Oh, sure, just coming home. I am now.
Oh, I see. Yeah. And tell me, what about the films?
Are there films too?
From a starry beginning, the emphasis then switched to a stronger focus on more short films and documentaries. To this day, still the groundstone of the festival. In 60 years, it wasn't without its many financial problems, and it also ruffled feathers along the way.
In 1969, for instance, the Bishop of Cork, Bishop Lucy, led a campaign against the film I Can't, saying that it was unworthy of Irish audiences as it concerned the issue of contraception. And later on, of course, we had the issue of Martin Scorsese's The Last Temptation of Christ in 1988. And this was an imagined account of the role of Jesus Christ as an ordinary man. Here in Ireland, when people did go in to see the film, many of them did walk out, but not in protest, but due to utter and complete boredom.
Over six decades, the festival grew hand in hand with a burgeoning Irish film industry, including the opening of Ardmore Studios and careers of filmmakers such as Joe Comerford and Neil Jordan. Since last year, the winners of the Short Film Awards in Cork automatically go onto a long list for the Oscars. And some of this year's shorts touch on very current topics.
Dennis Fitzpatrick and Ken Williams co-directed a short called The Break. It's a very tender and human exploration of a sort of post-economic crash and homelessness. Lovely, a lovely film. The great Brian Dean has a couple of movies in competition this year, and his really amazingly accomplished horror, Blight, is something to look out for.
The nightmares started weeks back. Then she'd see things. Now she said she hears voices.
Who's the father?
She won't say.
And then also very close to Cork's heart, is a presentation of the documentary and concert performance of Taste, Rory Gallagher's band, when they played for the last time together live at the Isle of Wight, an extraordinary sort of 12 songs footage there by the Oscar-winning documentary filmmaker Murray Lerner. What's going on?
And what would be one of the main highlights of this year's festival?
We're very grateful to Universal for having given us the Irish premiere of Danny Boyle's biopic of Steve Jobs, the creator of Apple Technology Company. And Steve Jobs is played by Michael Fassbender, who, being a Kerryman, is claimed by us practically here in Cork. And it seems fitting in a way. It's almost like we feel like we're welcoming the movie home in a way, given that Apple has chosen Cork to house its European headquarters.
I think possibly when people look back in 60 years' time at the Cork Film Festival, they will look fondly and hear fondly the click of the projector and the use of the non-digital type of media. So there's something very exciting about the future. What Dermot Green started is forever going to remain within the Cork cultural life.